may be seated. The topic is becoming a student of eternal life. Becoming a student of the supernatural, really what the eternal. Things that are eternal are spiritual. They last forever. Metal ain't going to last forever. Gold is not going to last forever. Wood is not going to last forever. These things in this physiological world are going to burn up, are they? Yes, they are. They're going to burn. But what ain't going to burn is something that's eternal. Your eternal life is going to be forever, whether that's with God or in the lake of fire. I believe that it's going to be with God. Just don't let me believe it for you, but you counter that belief and say, I believe that myself. I can't believe it for you. You got to believe it for yourself. As bad as I want you to have it, as bad as God wants you to have it, you got to do something. I give myself. The first, I used to want to give offerings so bad. I remember when I wanted to give. Churches back then were giving dues. They didn't believe in tithe. And I messed around and wanted to up my giving. And then I gave more. I gave tithe. And the dues person said, hey, come here. What you trying to do? I said, I ain't trying to do nothing. I'm doing what the Bible say. But we don't get tithes. We get dues. But God, as later on, as I was trying to learn that, God said, the first offering you need to give is yourself. Get in the basket yourself. Give me you. I got in the basket. Guess what happened? My life changed. I never jumped out. I offered myself to God. Now, the best offering you can give to God is yourself. Everything else comes easy. Once you give up and surrender, everything else comes easy. I'm telling you, it wasn't a rough transition for me from sinner to saint. It wasn't, because I was tired of sin. When you ain't tired of it, what makes it hard? Sin had did a number on me. After I read what happened to Jesus, man, that messed me up. After I read, now, with that being said, our subtopic this morning, becoming a student of eternal life. Now, if we're going to become a student of things, life eternal, then what's got to happen? We got to be a student of things we cannot see, tangibly touch, or feel. There's a supernatural realm we got to become a student of. Uh-oh. Why we look not at things that are seen. Now, Colossians 3:1. If we amplify, say, we then be risen with Christ. Haven't we been resurrected from the dead? Seek, aim at those things which are where above, where Christ sitteth and where you are in Christ on the right hand of the Father. And the Bible said, keep your mind set on things above. And if you keep them set on the high thing, on the spiritual thing, in the parent realm, you won't get caught up in this physiological world feeling like you're a failure, feeling like you this and feeling you like this. You in God's family. You've been elevated. You're a brand new creature in Christ, an ambassador, a high-ranking official. Amen. Our subtopic this morning, salvation wears the same on everybody. Oh, every believer. Every believer, salvation looks the same. Salvation looks the same on every believer. And I got that from Isaiah. And I got some scriptures. We're going to move along swiftly through this because it's already 16 till. So, Isaiah 61. Isaiah 61, a prophet of God, who started off being popular with Israel. He was preaching good word, and Israel backslid. God told Isaiah to say some things, and Isaiah went to preaching, and the people got mad with him. And finally, they took him and separated him, pulled him apart, tore him in half. Jesus said, all my prophets, my father sent prophets to you. You killed them one by one. Say, if I send my son, they'll reverence him. They got rid of him too. Say, if we kill a son, we can run this thing. Amen. Verse 10, I camp out here. I will rejoice greatly in the Lord. My soul, see, your soul didn't get saved when you got born again. My soul will exalt in my God. The only time you should exalt your soul and be joyful in the Lord, because we got a lot to be joyful for. He has clothed me with garments. S. Of salvation. Wait a minute. See, the garment that God passed out, it's the same across the board. Now, in the biblical days, Jesus made a comparison on a wedding feast. He said a man got in the wedding feast called the bridegroom, passed out wedding garments to his wedding. Everybody got in the wedding had on certain clothes. And when a stranger got in there, he stood out because he didn't have a garment on. And the man came up, hey, how did you get up in here with no garment? He snuck in, bind him hand and foot, and they cast him out in the outer darkness. What is that saying? You just ain't going to slip in. Salvation looks the same on me as on my wife, on Terrence, on him, on them children right there, on all of us, salvation looked the same. Now, the gifts and callings are different, but salvation, and this is what hurts me. Everybody got their own way to be saved. Everybody gonna be saved. No, everybody not. Everybody don't want to be saved. When Jesus died, he died for the world, but the world is not going to accept him. Do you not know before Jesus left this earth and died, didn't many people believe in him? They turned their back on the man. It was a man full of sorrow, acquainted with grief. He had no beauty that they should desire him. They didn't want to have nothing to do with Jesus. Now, did they eat the fish sandwiches? Did he heal their families? Yes, he did. Did he pay their taxes and do all them great things for them? And at the end, what did they do? Turned on him. And did he know it? Did he demonstrate love? Did we ever read Jesus was behind a sheep pen? Lord, there you go. Hey, Daddy. They're going to turn on me. I already know they're going to turn on me. He never said that. Only thing he did say, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. So, salvation looked the same on a holiness church, a Baptist church, a sanctified church, Episcopalian, Catholic. Salvation wears the same, but the confusion come in, and Satan is the author of confusion, that everybody saved their way. Sorry, Jesus said, John 14:6, I am the way to the Father. You don't come by me. That John 10 says that, but John 14:6 said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. But John 10 said, I am the door of the sheepfold. If you climb up any other way, you come up as a thief and a robber. You're not getting past Jesus because he's the door. He's the entry point to a relationship with God. Yeah, yeah. So salvation looks the same on all of us. So now, you may be in your first year of salvation. Some may be in their 10th year. Some may be in. So the ones in their 10th year should be producing more fruit, should be have more fruit on the tree. And the ones just starting, the baby fruit, it's still going, if they grow, it's going to turn out to be the same fruit. So there's no difference in that. But what I found out, and what you also know, everybody say they saved. Everybody say they like Christ. That ain't true. That's not true. Let's see. Psalms 15. I read this Wednesday night, and I'll read it again. Psalms 15 and 1 through 6. O Lord, who may lodge as a guest in your tent, in your house? A tent was a house. They dwell in tents back then. Amen. Who may? That's a question. O Lord, who may lodge as a guest in your tent? In your house, who may dwell continually on your holy hill. Talking about holy hill. Now, we ain't talking about just any hill. He who walks, you can answer both questions. He who walks with integrity, that's salvation. And strength of character, salvation. And works of righteousness, because you got a right spirit now. And speaks and holds the truth in his heart. Three, he does not slander with his tongue, nor does evil to his neighbor, nor takes up a reproach against his friends. Four, in his eyes an evil person is despised. How do we feel about evil? Do we glorify the evil? Before I got born again, I was for Scarface. I was for John Dillinger. I was for Bonnie and Clyde. I was for the dirty side of wrestling. Anything that was dirty, immoral, fattening, wrong, count me in. Mess around and got born again. Got born again. I wanted nothing to do with wrong no more. All of a sudden, I couldn't be for the dirty side of wrestling, even though it was fake. So I was rooting for the good side. Watching T.J. Hooker. I used to want the cops not to catch him. Got saved. I'm rooting for the cops now. What happened? Something happened on the inside. See, when you let him in, it's going to change. I didn't do nothing. Didn't have that much knowledge about the word, but there was an inward change. My desires changed. And Big Cat said, we thought you had got off the face of the earth. Nobody heard from you or seen from you. Guess what I did? Got away from everybody that looked like me, smelled like me, sounded like me. I locked up in my house with my Bible. And I got to know who this God is that served me. Now, I ain't gonna get involved with nothing about without doing some research. You ought to have enough research about God to where you sure and fully persuaded that God is who he say he is. We ought to be there by now. So, I'm just telling you what happened to me. So, I will not uphold a wicked person. I don't care how successful they are, black, white, polka dotted, green. I'm not impressed by your money. But if you don't repent, you're going to likewise perish. I don't care who you are. And this world is a system all by itself. There's a system of God. It's called the kingdom way of doing things. And there's a system of the world, which has already failed. I want you to get that one. Now, let me finish reading this. It said, in his eyes, an evil person is despised. They despise me. Well, the Bible said, if you're evil, we're supposed to despise you. No, it didn't say that. Verse 4, it did say that. But he who honor those who fear the Lord, we honor those who have honor for God. Those are the people we give honor to who honor God. If you don't honor God, we can't give you no honor. That's what salvation, see, we have to learn these things. We have to become a student of these things. Well, just knowing he died and rose and got to be born again ain't going to get it. And so many think they are okay. But I feel sorry because Christ come back. There's a lot of people may not go back based on them thinking Christ died for everybody. Everybody going to be saved anyway. I used to work with a white girl. Thought that. Neighbor church believed in predestination. I'm going to be saved, so I'm going to keep living sinful. That Friday, I had a talk with her. She died over the weekend. Wonder what happened to her. I ain't got to wonder. Why did God have me there talking to her? To try to explain to her, your idea of predestination is totally wrong. God called me. If I hadn't came out, I would have died. She left this earth waiting on God to call her out of sin. No, he already had called you the day you hear my voice. Harden not your heart. Let me keep reading. See, your soul is too valuable to play with, and I'm definitely not going to play with your soul. I'm not going to do it. Listen, but he who honors those who fear the Lord, listen, and obediently worship him with awe-inspired reverence and submissive wonder. He keeps his word even to his own hurt or disadvantage. So I had to learn this one from God. God had never lied to me. If I promise you something to my hurt, even if I lose, I got to make good on it because I let it come out of my mouth. God has kept every word he has given to me. God has not failed me not one time. And even if great things are ahead, he ain't lying. God ain't lying to me. I'm preparing for them great things. And you better prepare for them too. Well, I don't believe. Well, you can't have what you don't believe. Amen. So listen. He keeps his word even to his own disadvantage and does not change it for his own benefit. My bad. You won't get that out of God. For listen, 5, he does not put out his money at interest to his fellow Israelites. You got people on jobs seeing them lending money to make money off people. And does not take a bribe against the innocent. Uh-oh. The Bible says if you ain't an honest person, nobody should even be asking you what you saw in the first place. Your reputation is you dishonest. We can't trust you. And the church go get the biggest liars to bear witness on something. But the Bible said if you ain't trustworthy, nobody going to ask you. Because they know what's finna come. Get on the stand, do you pray to tell the truth, does but true as I go, and get up there lying on Perry Mason. Me and my wife used to watch that time going to sleep. I said, they lying. She said, boy, calm down. You can look at him and tell they lying. Perry Mason, you know he gonna win anyway. He don't lose. Madlock too. Anyway. It says, he who does these things will never be shaken. Never be shaken. I said 6, didn't I? It ain't 6, it's 5. Yeah, this is the Amplified version. So, what does salvation look like? Jesus left, listen, this is my thought. Jesus left no absolutely no doubt in these words to his disciples. He left no word that when you seen me, you seen the Father. It would be bizarre to accuse your doctor, your mom and dad, the dentist, God, of unfairness. What do you mean? It would be unfair for you to choose, accuse your doctor of being unfair by giving you remedies that work in your life. How can you blame him for telling you what work? A doctor, a dentist, your mom and dad, God. Hold your book up. He's giving you a book. How you going to hold him accountable and he's giving you what, telling you what's right? How can God be accused when he's giving you the remedy that works? The Bible full of mistakes. Full of punctuation, but every scripture is inspired by God. No, ain't no mistake with the Bible. But what about them lost books? I had to tell one preacher they not knowing it because they not in the 66 wrapped in one. If God wanted them lost books to be in that 66 wrapped in one, they would have been there. God knows everything. That book you hold on your lap is anointed and it is inspired by God. Them books, whoever wrote them, ain't. Ain't. I don't waste my time with them. I don't waste my time with that kind of stuff. Listen. Number one, the man that God called as the apostles, the disciples, then they became apostles, confirmed his message by consistently preaching that salvation comes through faith in Jesus alone. Did they not consistently preach that? All right. What they saying now? Everybody can be saved. Steve Harvey says 800 channels, so there are 800 channels to get to God. He tried to compare cable TV to so many different ways to God. I'm like, the human brain say, these theologians of today say, we just can't see God being a loving God. No, you can't see. Let me ask y'all something. Noah preached 120 years. Plus 7 days, God said, do a week of revival. I'm going to give them some more grace. Is that love? Was God unmerciful? 120 years? Did Noah fail in his mission? What happened? The people failed to receive God's goodness. They failed to get on that ark. Who was the ark? Symbolic to Jesus. Where was Jesus stuck at? In the side. Well, he had a hole in his side. Jesus said, put your hand in there. That's how big the hole was. That ark had a door in the side, meaning that door where Noah and his family and them animals entered, they entered into safety. Everyone that was in that ark represented Christ, and nobody drowned. And Noah's obedience condemned the world. Your obedience condemning. Your obedience is condemning folks. This is why. This is why. Big Cat, you remember that day I came looking for Mike and I saw you weren't saved and you were nowhere ready to come here. And what everybody started doing when they saw me pull up? What'd I tell them? Don't put that up. Y'all know what I used to do? Man, we just want to respect you. I said, I ain't worried about that. Don't put that up. But one thing somebody told me, man, when you got out that car, we saw a number of light. Because why? It wasn't so much I was just lit up. They was in darkness. If we don't do what we're supposed to do, the world will never be condemned. God told me when I married my wife, and I'm glad God picked up for me because I'm a fool. I don't know how to pick nothing. I can't pick. He said, live to convict. Meaning, you're going to have to live right if you're going to win over. If you're going to win somebody over, your lifestyle, they ain't mad with you. They mad with the God in you. Because the God in you going to hold. It's going to hold up. You can throw bricks. I'm talking spiritual. You can throw insults. I heard them all through my wonderful wife now, which I'm so thankful to be with now. Finally got some peace in my life. I can sleep now. But all that came. But I knew a change was coming. Don't get moved off all this stuff that's going on in the world because, yeah, they're going to talk about it. They talk about Jesus. If they cuss me out, what do you think they're going to do to you? Who are you? You don't cuss me. I'm a child of God. Well, they cuss Jesus. Sick them, Jesus. Jesus ain't no dope mama pincher. Jesus going to get you. I told one guy why he ain't got you yet. If he gets you, then I know he'll get me. Oh, my God, going to get me. Do y'all hear that? The message got to constantly be preached. Didn't they constantly preach Jesus is Lord? Didn't Peter get up on Pentecost and say, you elders, you the one crucified him, you killed him, you murdered him? He let them know, the same Jesus whom you hung on the tree. But Noah condemned the world. All right, let's take it on further. What else did God do? Nineveh. Did Jonah fail? Jonah didn't fail. Jonah, God was doing a twofold deal. God was working out selfishness in Jonah, a hard heart, by sending him to preach to his enemy. Then he got mad when God forgave him. Didn't I tell you I didn't want to go? You gonna forgive him anyway? Boy, Jonah had a hard heart. And he ain't the only preacher. He ain't the only preacher. It's a lot of preachers hadn't made that transition to where they want to see the people get born again. They don't want to see the church up and running full throttle. What the world would be if every church was operating a 100 on everything God said. Whoa, glory to God. It'll be heaven on earth. Man, that's what I'm waiting on, the church to catch on to what God won't done. Let me move on. All right, number two, Christ himself didn't leave that option open to us. Either he is Lord over all or he isn't Lord at all. One or the other. All right, now, let's get this. Give me 2 Timothy, please. 2 Timothy, Jeremy, 3. 2 Timothy, 3. Third chapter, 2 Timothy, 3rd chapter, 5 through 7 verse. Let me get over here. 2 Timothy. Amen. Salvation looks the same on everybody. Now, we believe in the golden calf, we believe in this and that. I don't know what kind of salvation that is. But the salvation God provided is for everybody. It looks the same. The garment of salvation, the robe of righteousness. You got a garment of salvation and you got a robe of righteousness. Now Second Timothy, let me get over here. Second Timothy 3, here we go. Having a form of godliness. Looking the part, but ain't no power there. Doing the two-step. Doing the tongue. Ain't no power. Listen, having a form of godliness, but denying God's power to have access through your life. Yes. From such, turn away. Now, I ran from that, but I didn't run from the devil using me. I let the devil have full access, but I'm running from what God want to do through me. Wow. Is that only me? No, but I'm telling you, it's time for the church to take its place. Let me read this. Thank you right there. Let me read this. Holding to a form of outward godliness, religion, although they have denied its power, for their conduct nullifies their claim of faith. Your conduct nullifies their claim of faith of being saved, or their faith in Christ, the way you act, the way you carry yourself. Everybody a Christian now? Don't think so. Avoid such people and keep away from them. You got any friends like this? What did the word say? I'm saying what the word say, right? The word is the final authority, right? What did he say? Keep away from these folks. Who? Holding to a form of outward godliness, looking outwardly, ain't nothing on the inside. Although they have denied its power, their conduct, the way they act, the way they carry themselves, nullifies their claim of faith in Jesus. Avoid such people and keep far away from them. See, that's why I don't like going to church, because that man always talking about that stuff right there. But see, this is the delivery ministry. You want to get delivered, then give God opportunity. Yes. Yes. Amen. Give God that opportunity. Six, for among them are those who worm their way into homes and captive, morally weak and spiritually dwarfed women, weighed down by the burden of their sins, easily swayed by various impulses. Now, wait a minute now. It's easy to know that Peter Popoff is a fake. Anybody can look at Peter Popoff and tell. That man been run out of every town. Yeah, as long as he got money, they're going to let him on the TV. Robert Tilton, another. And those are obvious ones. But what about the ones that are not that obvious? What about them? Listen, here we go. It says here, swayed by various impulses, verse 7, always learning and listening to anybody who will teach them, but never able to come into the knowledge of the true salvation. We got to get the real knowledge, and I'm afraid these pastors, along with myself, we going to have to give an account. This podium have heard a lot of people, lying to people, placating to people. Dr. Bowie was my first instructor at Koinonia on Clinton Boulevard when I went to a seminary over there. That brother was sharp in analytic, homiletic, hermeneutics. But that ain't going to save you. I learned all this stuff. I don't even talk about homiletics, hermeneutics. Sound good. And all I know a seminarian, when they get up and they're going to grab the podium, they're going to look pious. I'm already knowing where they come from. And they're going to look out, looking all pious. And they're going to come with this greeting, a seminarian talk. I never used it. Because I was looking at Jesus' life. Jesus never used that stuff. Jesus kept it simple and plain. I patterned my ministry. He gave me the ministry. It's his ministry, so why would I not keep it patterned after him? Make it simple. Wasn't nothing hard about Jesus with telling people. Didn't they know about sheep? Didn't they know about grapes? Didn't they know about bread? Didn't they know about yeast? Why did he keep it in the context in which they could grasp if they so chose? So what we do here is make it plain, make it simple, give you the answers. And every time you choose to go against the word of salvation, you choose to fail. Let me get on with this. We're going somewhere. I want y'all to hear me this morning. I want you to hear this in the form of encouragement. God want to work through you. He want to love through you. He want to do it all through you. What verse am I at? That was verse 7? All right. These Janice and Jamborees. I ain't got time to deal with these folk. Chapter 4. Pull up chapter 4, Jamie. And let me read. I said I was going to hit that since I'm over there. Okay? Let me move on. 61 and 11. I'll go back and get that. All right. I charge thee before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick, that means alive, and the dead, at his appearing. That's going to be a long judgment, ain't it? Yes, Lord, everything done in this body, we're going to have to give an account of. Yeah, it ain't going to mean it's going to be all bad now. No, it ain't going to be all bad. God has already forgiven us, but he want to bring this stuff back up and let you see how you going to look in front of him, how I'm going to look in front of him, appearing and his kingdom. Two, come on, watch this. This is what, preach the word. Be instant, in season, be ready, out of season. I'll preach Easter at Christmas. And some churches want to keep Easter. I don't believe in Easter, but keep the Easter message at Easter. Keep Christmas at Christmas. You got to preach as he leads you to preach. Preach the word. Don't preach your opinion. Preach the word. In season, out of season. Reprove. What do the word going to do? It's going to reprove you. I want you to look up the word reprove. Look up the word rebuke. Look up the word exhort with all long suffering. That means exalt the people. You got to bear long, suffer long when people ain't getting it right. Be patient with these people. I didn't get it right overnight, but they laughed at me, Tan. But I be patient. When I wasn't patient with you. I'm patient with everybody. I'm patient with you, Lily. Keita. I'm patient with my mom. I'm patient with everybody, and I was patient with my baby. I saw mama in the pew struggling, but I was patient. Said, Lord, she's going to get it. But she finally broke through. God sent her here to help me. And the only way that was going to do, that had to be broken. And she said that herself. Same thing on my wife. I'm sitting there watching her go through. I said, she hanging there. She's going to make it. But I'm rooting. I'm cheerleading. Got my pom-pom and my cheerleading skirt spiritually. He got a skirt on, but I'm talking. I'm cheering you on. I want you to go through. By going through, this is what can't happen. Let's say we walk up on an egg of a bird. And the bird is struggling. Let's help it. No help to that. Why we shouldn't help that? Y'all know, when he using his little muscles he ain't ever used to break out of that egg, he's building up endurance for the elements outside. It's going to be a lot of times you're going to want help. God ain't sending nobody because he wants you to develop. He wants you to develop. There's been times the way I wanted to come in there, go, let him go. Let him go. Don't go there. Don't call. Don't do nothing. Amen. God knows what he's doing. Because there's been time where I wanted, when I was coming up, it was just a pew sitter. Nobody. God said, you don't need nobody. I want to see what you're going to do. Some of the best times in my life. Knowing what you got to go through. And when you go through it, can't nobody take that from you. Can't nobody, you know. See, you done went from believing, from faith to faith, from believing to knowing. That's where you at. Now they're going to call you arrogant. Who he think he is? No, you're a child of God. That's all. That's all. You're a child of God. Well, okay, come on. I'm trying to find myself. Preach the word, be instant, reprove, okay, with all long-suffering and doctrine. Verse 3, come on. We're here now, ain't we? For the time will come. We right here. That was way back then, and we're here now. When they, who is they, will not endure sound doctrine. Where is this word supposed to be preached? In the house of God. And it's a time to where they don't want to hear. They want to hear, she'll be coming round the mountain when she comes. She'll be coming. They want to hear that kind of stuff. Ain't he all right? Ha! The law! Ha! Yeah! Ha! The law! Ha! Ain't he? Yeah. See, that's what they want. That ain't sound doctrine right there. I'm sorry. I might get some feedback. I always do. You know, he's crazy. But after their own lust, they're going to go find a preacher that's going to tickle their ears and tell them what they want to hear. For, come on, and they shall turn away their ears from Jesus. What's it? He said, I am the way, the truth. From the truth. That's why we got to teach it. This is why he said, lest it go to the four corners of the earth. I ain't coming back to the truth, to the gospel, to the power. Go to the four corners of the earth. This stuff got to be preached everywhere. And if we walk in obedience and you fulfill your role, your calling, walk worthy wherewith you were called, you're condemning the world. And don't think they gonna like it. They're not gonna like it. You ain't doing nothing but living saved. But that Jesus gone. That's all you gotta do. You ain't gotta do nothing but wake up and live. And live saved, and you're condemning this universe. You condemning this world. Noah condemned the earth when God told him how to build it, told him where to build it, what kind of wood, what kind of everything. Noah obeyed, and the Bible said he condemned the world with his obedience to God. What are we doing? You're building an ark of safety for your loved ones. This is serious work here. Amen. Well, man. All right, so the gifts and calling. Romans 11 and 28, don't go there. In 29, these verses go together. The gifts and callings are different. But salvation is the same for all. It looks the same on all who receive it. Well, I've heard people say, well, I heard what you said. Man, I used to go and preach. Somebody told me, why you make me feel like I ain't saved when you come over here and preach? I said, you know the answer. Kept walking. Every time you come in, you make me feel like I ain't saved. I said, you know the answer. All I was doing was preaching the truth. You got to give people a chance to hear the truth. Don't try to spare people's feelings. Nobody in here, I don't believe, like hurting people's feelings. But if you love somebody, tell them the truth. You're hurting them when you don't be honest with them. Amen? But listen, no one that is born again is born in spiritual sickness. I was watching the game. And God hit me. I got up from my recline and started right. God was talking to me all day. It started 3:34 Saturday morning. And I got up. I told my wife, I got up early out of bed because I had to put this stuff down. Now, here we go. Listen. Being born again, no one that is born again is born into spiritual sickness. You ain't sick no more if you born again. You better get that one in your spirit. I said, God, I said, I see where you're going with this. Do we need to go back to Isaiah 52 and 14? Jesus was sick. He died full of sin, poverty, disease. He died with cancer, lupus, AIDS, COVID-19, the Arbitron, Arbor Goose, Arbor whatever. He died with ovarian cancer. He died with, you name it. He looked grotesque. It was because they beat him like that. It was because all of that, but every disease known to the human body, he died with it. Now that you're born again, your sin nature has been destroyed. Where the sickness going to come from? Come on now. I want you to catch up with me in the spirit now. Where is the sickness going to come from? We were sin sick. Thanks to who? Adam. Adam made the whole human race sin sick. Christ said, I got the antidote. I got the antidote. And everybody claiming him should claim spiritual deliverance from your spiritual sickness, because Romans 6 said your sin nature, Terrence, what did you say this morning? That sin ain't your master no more. So it's by choice. If we sin, we sin by choice, because you ain't sin sick no more. You are spiritually whole, complete. What did Jesus tell that woman with this issue of blood? She gave all her money to the doctors. Had been like that 12 years. Didn't even supposed to be outside. Jesus was on his way to Jairus' house. And she said, but if I could just touch the hem of his garment. Don't use Jesus as your last resort. But if you just tried everything else and Jesus left, he ain't going to disappoint you. That woman went in behind, if I could touch the hem. In Jesus' shawl, that prayer shawl, it was a blue border in that prayer shawl. In Leviticus, it's a verse. I taught the verse. I ain't go back and get it because it's there. There's healing in that border. That woman knew that and believed it and went in behind Jesus on her knee. Jairus saw that woman. He was a ruler in the synagogue. Who could have condemned her? Jairus could have. She had a condition. She had been hemorrhaging for 12 years. No woman in that condition should have been in public. It was against the law at that time for a woman to be in that condition. Jairus didn't open up his mouth. He was concerned about his daughter. Jesus healed that woman, and he said, daughter, go, for your faith, he has made you. If she had a husband and he left because of that, she got another one. She lost all her money at the dollar. I'm talking about whole now. You got to understand, with everything came back. You see, y'all better get with me. You don't lose with God. Everything you lost before you became whole coming back. You ain't sick no more. Adam and Eve, wait a minute. It don't supposed to be any sinners on earth today. God didn't make sinner man in his image to be sinners. So when Adam made everybody sick, Christ had to come up with a plan. God came up with a plan before that happened. And 42 generations later, here come the antidote. Did he fix the problem? Did the problem hang on there? Did they behold his ugliness? Did they say he was stridden, smitten of God? He was cursed. Yeah, he took your curse, my curse. He took your poverty, your pain, your disease. Now, when you receive Jesus, you receive wholeness. Nothing missing, nothing broken. You ain't sent sick no more. Make up your mind. You a complete brother. You a complete sister. You whole. You ain't sent sick no more. Now you can walk above. We ain't putting up with that mess over here. That's what God gave me. I'm glad I got up from that game. Now, aren't we? I got to get this. 2 Corinthians 5 and 17. We're brand new creatures. Didn't he say that? Let me get over here. 2 Corinthians 5 and 17. Let me get here. I don't know y'all know this, but Tanya, don't ever apologize and say, well, I know you're tired of hearing it. We need to keep hearing it, son. Don't ever say that, because we need to hear. We need to keep hearing it. We need to keep hearing it. You say it, I say it, Mama Abram say it, Keita say it, my wife say it. We all going to say it. We going to say it because it's true. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, that is engrafted in, listen, is joined to him. Now, how sickness going to be joined to him? By faith in him as Savior. He saved you from sickness. Come on, y'all. He is a new creature, reborn, renewed by the Holy Spirit. The old sickness, the old previous moral, spiritual sickness condition, I'm adding that in there, has passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Because, listen, all things, behold, new things have come because of spiritual awakening brings a new life. Did y'all hear that? Now, listen to this. 19. No, I get 20. So we are ambassadors for Christ. How are you going to be an ambassador sick? you're whole. Sin has been destroyed. You ain't sick, you're whole. You're complete. As though God were making his appeal through us who are sick. No. Jesus was sick. He could touch leprosy. Hello? That man that spit in that man in that hand and rubbed that in that man's face, we ain't talking about that. God ain't told that man to do that. Did y'all see that? You see that thing? That God ain't told that man to do. Somebody, what you think? I said, I don't think. I ain't going to even entertain. But I said this. They had that agreement before. Because if they had a call you up there and did that to you, what you would have did? Well, like I said in Sunday school, sometimes God allow physical things to bring the worldliness out of you. That man would have been choked out up there. But they had that plan. You know they did. Let me find my plate. Where am I? Okay. They're making his appeal. Listen, you, can we make a good appeal? Can God make a good appeal through us sick? No. Broken, not whole and complete. As Christ represented, plead with you on behalf of Christ. Be reconciled to God. Y'all hear me? 21. He made Christ who knew no sin. Listen. To judicially be sin on our behalf, to become sick for us on our behalf. You don't hear me? That in him we would become the righteousness of God. That is, we would be made acceptable to him and placed in right relationship with him by his gracious, loving kindness. We ain't sick no more. Say, I ain't sin sick no more. I had an antidote inside of me. Amen, amen, amen. Now, 2 Peter 1, 8 and 9. Pull that up, Tina. Jeremy. I'm excited now. Jesus said, listen, I won't, before we go there, Adam's sin made everyone sick. 2 Peter. And we got 2 Peter 1, 8 and 9. Write that down. 1 Peter 4, 1 through 4. First Peter, y'all already know what that means. First Peter, it might be Second Peter. It's First Peter 4. First Peter 4, okay. This gonna prove to you that you ain't sick no more. That's all I'm trying to do. Trying to reiterate the fact. You can live a book. So now, every time anybody go to St. Louis with us when we went to St. Louis and I preached at that church, right down from that boy where he got killed in St. Louis. And God gave me a topic. When you don't obey the word of God, you choose to fail. That popped up in my spirit last night. When you don't trust or obey the word of God, you choosing failure. Why is that? Why is that? You don't lose obeying God with God. You don't lose when you obey God. It might not work as fast as you want it to work, but it's gonna prove out. It's gonna prove out. God ain't gonna have you looking crazy, and you ain't gonna mar God. Here go people. I tried that Bible. I tried God. Your heart wasn't right. Something ain't right. Cause it ain't never God, y'all. When it didn't work, I went back to me. I didn't go to God. I ain't crazy. I went to me. Come on. And sometimes God will tell you be patient. Just like with my knee. You know, I said, well, if I got to have a surgery, I'm going to make my mind up to have surgery. But I said, God, he said, son, faith ain't your problem. Patience. You learn patience, go back and get it. I'm like, okay. Now, I was telling my wife, as cold as it been, it ain't act up not one time. Come on. If these things be in you and abound, they make you that you should neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of salvation. You ain't going to be barren. You ain't going to be sick. You ain't going to be in lack. You ain't going to be in none of this stuff. Come on. Come on. Watch this. But he that lacketh these things is blind, cannot see, afar. You only can see right in front. God wants us to see into the supernatural now. And has forgotten that he was what? Purged, cleansed from sickness. When you see sin, it says sickness now. That's what it is, ain't it? Why? And so what is that saying? Come on. What, give me 10. Give me 10. Wherefore, rather, brethren, give diligence to make your calling and election sure. For if you do these things, you should never. So you should never fall. And what he's saying is, we're talking about salvation. You will never fall away from your salvation. You will never fall. 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 And then one of the verses I didn't write down, if I did, it's on the back. Oh, I went to write. God was still talking. Let me see, two people, okay. I think I'm about through here. I got time. All right, here we go. Give me Peter, 1 Peter 4 and 17. And then we're going to move on, and we're getting ready to close. For the time has come that judgment must begin where? And God has judged through COVID. He is judged. And now God spoke that to me. And judgment, all judgment ain't bad, y'all. Come on now. Don't get in your mind that somebody finna, God finna bring the hammer down. No, that could be a good thing. God is judging you to reward you. It ain't got to be evil. Come on now, if you've been practicing that, then you got to renew your mind and get it in the right frame now. Now, if it's going there, because that ain't where I'm going. Let me find it. It says, for the time, for it is time, destined for judgment to begin at the household of God. For it begins at us. What will the outcome for those who do not respect or believe or obey the gospel of God? Come on. Put your one up, Jerry. Come on, next verse. What's going to happen to them who disrespect? For if the righteous scarcely be saved. Listen. And it is difficult for the righteous to be saved. And if it is difficult for the righteous to be saved, what will become of the godless and the sinner? What's going to happen to them if it's difficult for us to be saved? What's going to happen to these people who think they okay? It ain't going to be good. Next verse, Jerry. Wherefore, let them that suffer according to the will of God commit to keeping of their soul to him in well-doing as unto a faithful creator. Do y'all hear me? You gotta hold on. Jesus suffered. You're going to have to do a little suffering here. You're going to have to do a little suffering. But what's going to happen to these people who won't respect or obey the word of God? It ain't going to be good. The Bible said we barely getting by the skin of our teeth. Wow. Now, the Holy Spirit said Adam sinned and made everyone sick. Then he said by one man obedience made everybody righteous. Everybody healed now. Why do we keep thinking we sick? Jeremy, pull up 9. Matthew 19:26, and we're going to Mark 9:23. Why do we keep thinking that we're sick? I know a hypochondriac. She's in my family by marriage, and got my brother thinking everything happened. He's sick. That just is in his head, and if it could come real, if you don't get it out, that human brain is something else. Jesus said unto them, I want y'all to get with me on this, and we close then. Thank you, Holy Ghost. But Jesus beheld them and said unto them, with men it is what? Terrence said, and I piggybacked off what Terrence said. When I was a sinner, it was impossible for me to live right. Ain't nobody going to live right without God. Command didn't get here on his own. You can't take flesh and live right. It takes somebody greater than the substance, this dirt suit that we got. It's what's in you going to help you to be good and be right. But now if we bag up to verse 17, Jeremy, bag it up. Before we let, whoa. Gone, you done already started. Gone 17. He wanted to know what he like. He said unto him, why callest thou me good? Jesus said, why you calling me good? There's none good but one, that is God. But if thou will enter into life, what is he talking about? Zoe life, eternal life. Keep the commandments of love. That's what he's talking about. And you, and nobody got any excuse for not working out. You got a lot of things to forgive people for. Forgive yourself, number one. If you don't forgive you, you ain't gonna forgive nobody. I just tell you, every time about this year, I have a relapse. Yeah, because you need to forgive yourself. You ain't going to make God happy, a job about not forgiving yourself, having sackcloth and ashes on for 13 years. Come on. He said unto him, which, Jesus said, thou shalt, this is a commandment of love. If you love, why are you going to murder? If you murder your brother, if you hate your brother, you ain't murder, right? You got to love him. Thou shalt not commit adultery. If you love somebody, you ain't going to commit adultery. Thou shalt not steal. If you love somebody, you ain't going to steal from them. Thou shalt not bear false witness, because the love of the commandment of love covers everything. Jesus said it's one law hangs on the curtain rod of love. And it's hanged on the rod of love. If you don't love, you're curtain down. Everybody looking in your window. The rod off. Ain't no curtain up. Ain't no love there. Come on. That's love. Honor your father because you love him. Honor your mother. Love, thou shalt love your neighbor. It's all about love. Jesus is talking about keeping the commandment of love. Now watch this. Watch this young crazy person. Watch this. The young man said unto him, trying to show Jesus up, all these things I kept from my youth up. What lacketh I yet? Really? You want to play with Jesus like that? Jesus finna tell him. Don't ask Jesus what you're lacking. He'll tell you. Go to him and ask, Lord, what I ain't doing? Might hurt your feelings, but he ain't trying to hurt your feelings because he loves you. Jesus said unto him, if thou will be complete, whole, grow up. See, you know you're grown when you can go sell some of the stuff you steward over. You're a steward, don't even belong to you. Sell it. Sell that thou hast, give it to the, and thou shalt have in heaven, and come and watch this. Let's locate him. Jesus located. But when the young man heard that saying, he went away sorrowful. I read it this way, for great possessions had him, which was his God. Did y'all get that? Now, let's go back to 26. Now you see why he said that. He was talking to the disciples. When they saw that, they had a problem. Come on. But Jesus beheld his disciples and said unto them, with men, this is impossible. But with God. I ain't living without God, so to me, what God is asking me to do with kingdom favor is possible. God asking me to love my wife. See, salvation is perfect, it's complete, it works good. It's the individual who hadn't been a student of eternal life and salvation don't know. He ended up pulling stuff, turning this around. And when the commandments, they ask you to do that. He wants you to get in there and sit in it and get comfortable in there. But you ain't a student, so you go to pulling on stuff. Messing with. And so we said, this don't work right. But it do work right. Because it's perfect. The salvation God is talking about. What you have up there? With possible. It's impossible with man. With you doing it, trying to be right with God, trying to justify what you do to make you right with God. No, it's impossible. But not with God. For with God, all things are possible. What is it that you can't do? God, I know my heart. You know I ain't perfect. It's impossible with God. Give me Mark 9 and 23, and we close it. So take this with you. I can do all things through Christ. Whatever you've asked me to do is possible because I believe. Come on. Jesus said unto him, if thou can believe, all of, now, stop right there. Ain't everybody saying they believe? Listen to some of these believers. I ain't there yet. I'm in the process. You've been there 100 years. You stuck. Keep a process in your head for that long. David Ruffin had kept that perm in his head. It would have been ate out. Women, how long do you leave those chemicals in your head, that process? How long? How long do you leave the curling iron in there? I want some tight curl. Come on. Listen. Jesus said unto him, put your name there. If thou can believe, all things are possible to him that believe. Now, if you don't believe, he ain't talking to you. What is it that you say you believe? Then it's possible. If God said it, then it's possible. Let's not take our minds over into areas that these crazy folk talking. God know we gonna mess up. God know can't nobody live right. That ain't what Jesus said right there. That is not what Jesus said. Too many, listen. The world system has failed already, hasn't it? The kingdom system is God's way of doing things. Too many people are trying to complete a physical life and haven't learned how to live successfully being led by the Holy Spirit. I'm telling you, it's possible. Let me find my notes here that I was talking about believe. Okay, hold on. Let me get it. Absolute believing. And we're going to close. Believe. Let me find it. I got them right here. Believe. Yes, you are a believer. We are a believer. Yes, I'm a believer. Let me find it. Believe. Yes, we can do this. Okay, I'm looking for it. I always overlook it because, I'm overlooking it. Yep. Come on, give it to me. Okay. You know, you got that dictation. Where we at? Believe. The sinful nature was crucified with Christ on the cross. All believers have been crucified with Christ on the cross. A person's faith life is obedience. My personal interests and goals no longer direct my life. The Holy Spirit directs my life. Stewards must be found trustworthy. That's what believing is. It calls you to be trustworthy. You trust God. And it calls you to overcome the world. See, this is, and see, to believe is to be faithful to the scripture. That's what that's saying. You're full of it. Be easily persuaded that Jesus is the Word of God. Be confident in the Scripture. That's what believing is. But everybody say they believe, but Jesus says, "Paul, I can't do that. I can't do it, man. I just can't do it. Leon, I'm sorry, I can't do that. But I'm a believer with the intent of hearing and obeying. That's what that means. So." Am I really believed or do I'm just saying I'm a believer? Jesus said it's possible, then end the story. Don't let everybody know what you're doing because they'll talk you out of it. You better get with somebody got like precious faith and they can egg you on and boot you on. But you go to talking to these people or down there where the chicken's at, they want you down there with them. The obedience rises, it brings you on up. You ain't no better than them. You could have been there. You've been saved way longer than me. You still die there. Come on up here. So, all things are possible to you that believe. Ain't nobody in there sin sick. Your sin nature been destroyed. When that pressure of your flesh, I heard the mess, shut up. Choose the blessed life. I set before you blessings, curses, life, death. You got a choice. Choose life. We come out of the curse. We ain't cursed no more. Jesus took your curse. He bore your curse. Nobody in here is sitting sick anymore. You can overcome anything you put your mind to. You ain't struggling in that area. I don't struggle no more. The pressure of that is gone. I had to get there. So, anybody in here sitting sick? You've been made whole. It's possible if you believe it. Can you believe it? Well, you made whole then. Be it unto you according to your faith. In Jesus' name, God bless you. It's our message. We'll be right back.